Hello and welcome to the Intellectual Property course on ePathshala. Today we are going to discuss a module on patents, traditional knowledge and biodiversity. This module pertains primarily to the relationship between patents and traditional knowledge, including biodiversity, and how each region either are in conflict or in complementarity with each other. In briefly introducing you to this topic, we are going to discuss what is traditional knowledge. We are going to discuss primarily some of the terms and some of the definitional ambiguities in traditional knowledge, along with associated genetic resources. We are going to discuss certain international measures in protecting biodiversity and traditional knowledge, primarily through the Convention on Biological Diversity and the recently concluded Nagoya Protocol. We are going to discuss the most contested TRIPS-CBD relationship and how Article 27 of the TRIPS Agreement requires patents to be granted on life forms. At the same time, there are certain exclusions that can be provided. Furthermore, Article 27 also requires review of the particular provision. We are going to discuss all of it in this particular course module. Some of the measures that India has taken to protect traditional knowledge, including associated biodiversity, and how both in terms of positive and misappropriation or prevention of misappropriation regimes are structured in India. We are going to study some legal frameworks. In this, we are going to study if a national legislation on protecting TK is essential and what are the steps taken by India, how other legislations like geographical indications or common law customary practices relating to secrecy, common law regimes like passing off can help to protect traditional knowledge to a certain extent and certain aspects of traditional knowledge. There are also measures within the patent system which allow interested people in preventing misappropriation of traditional knowledge by requiring disclosure. Also, we'll discuss what are the key provisions in India's National Biodiversity Act and some certain measures taken by India relating to database protection through the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. Now, what is traditional knowledge? Primarily, there is no structured definition of traditional knowledge. And as we are going to see in our next slide, this definition is ridden with ambiguity, but it is necessary to see what might constitute the important ingredients of traditional knowledge. Generally, it is understood as some essential piece of knowledge that is transmitted from generations to generations, or what is also called as intergenerational equity. It is constantly evolving. It is not static in nature. It is quite dynamic in that every generation or subsequent generations are free to evolve it and evolve the knowledge. In that sense, it's not static. It is also understood as some form of collective responsibility and ownership. Generally, that it belongs to the humankind. Generally, it belongs to certain indigenous populations as they collectively hold it. But it does not mean that traditional knowledge always and in each case must belong to an identifiable, must be identifiable with any indigenous community as such. It can be identified with particular individuals. It can also be identified with groups and a region as a whole or a nation as a whole and across nations. Similarly, it can either be open and closed in the sense that open forms of traditional knowledge would mean that the knowledge associated with the genetic resource is largely widespread and allowed to be used by large sections of the public. In certain cases, the traditional knowledge associated with genetic resources are closed in the sense that only a particular group or an identifiable group or individuals can use the piece of knowledge. Now, TK includes not just traditional knowledge as such, distinct from associated genetic resources, but it also includes TKGRs, largely in case of medicinal knowledge, but it necessarily need not involve medicinal knowledge as such. TK can also be apart from medicinal knowledge. In general parlance, the term TK has been broadly construed also to include cultural expressions like music, poetry, handicrafts, etc. So there are certain attempts to define traditional knowledge. WIPO, the World Intellectual Property Organization, has taken some leading efforts in conveying what is called as the Intergovernmental Committee on TK associated with genetic resources. And in one of those key negotiations, certain provisions, certain definitions emerged. Now, it has been defined in the broad sense of the term, which must generally include intellectual and intangible cultural heritage, practices, knowledge system of traditional communities, including indigenous and local communities. Now, this was in one of the documents called as the draft gap analysis produced by the World Intellectual Property Organization. Hence, TK in the general sense embraces content of the knowledge itself as well as traditional cultural expressions like folklore, including distinctive signs and symbols associated with traditional knowledge. If you look into international measures and how TK and TK associated with genetic resources to mean biodiversity evolved in discussions, it was during the Earth Summit in 1992 which first raised this issue on TK and biodiversity. In fact, Principle 22 is very clear to the extent that indigenous people and their communities and other local communities have a vital role in environmental management and development because of their knowledge and traditional practices. States should recognize and duly support their identity, culture, and interest and enable their effective participation in achievement of sustainable development. Now, if you understand the import of this definition, it clearly does not use the word traditional knowledge as such, but it uses the word their knowledge and traditional practices and identifies it with indigenous people. Now, it is important to note that the CBD, Convention on Biological Diversity, and Principle 22 clearly relates all of this towards protection and achievement of sustainable development, protection of environment and achievement of sustainable development. Also, if we can recollect from the TRIPS agreement negotiations, these were not formally part of the Uruguay round negotiations, which led finally to the TRIPS agreement and the WTO set of agreements. However, post the TRIPS agreement, these became part of the discussions on Committee on Trade and Environment. In fact, in early 1995, the WTO came up with certain documents within the Committee on Trade and Environment, which clearly tried to narrate what might be the possible kind of relationship between TRIPS and CBD. And it stated that the Committee on Trade and Environment will consider the work program envisaged in the decision on trade and services and environment and relevant provisions of the TRIPS agreement now as an integral part of its work. However, discussions in the WTO moved from the Trade and Environment Committee to the TRIPS Council by way of Article 27.3b review, which we'll discuss in the later stage. Now, this review would require WTO member countries to consider how they effectively implemented certain provisions relating to biotechnology or life form patents within their national laws. And it was in this context that discussions between a kind of conflict between TRIPS and CBD was sought to be discussed. Now, international measures pertaining to conventional biological diversity has three main goals. One is conservation of biological diversity. Second is the sustainable use of its components of what constitutes biodiversity. And third is fair and equitable benefit sharing arising from such genetic resources. Now, if you look into the core of the relationship that is shared between between biodiversity and patenting aspects relating to biodiversity, then the two key provisions that emerge is the prior informed consent and access and benefit sharing. Now, prior informed consent would mean that before accessing the resource, proper consent must be accrued through authorities. And access and benefit sharing would mean that those identifiable communities, and if not identifiable, at least towards the state, the benefits that accrue out of commercialization of biodiversity must flow through. Convention on Biological Diversity also discusses access and transfer of technology, including biotechnology, to the governments and local communities that provide traditional knowledge or biodiversity resources. Now, these are not directly pertaining to access and benefit sharing in terms of monetary gains, but may involve transfer of technology requirements also. The Nagoya Protocol on access and to genetic resources and fair and equitable treatment of benefits arising from the CBD, it specifically establishes a kind of framework that is required for predictable conditions to access to genetic resources and also helping ensure how benefit sharing agreements and how benefit sharing of genetic resources between the contracting parties can be provided.